Good morning, caffeinators.
Hey, everybody.
Welcome to the Vet Tech Tap Room, where your favorite beer is always on draft. Dave, I know you're doing Whole 30, so I know you're not drinking anything,
yeah.
But I do have, it's early for us here on the West Coast. I do have a double coffee bourbon barrel aged stout that I'm going to be working on for this episode.
That sounds delicious. I mean, mm-hmm. aside from your flavor choices for coffee, most of your beer choices, I am mostly on board with until you pull out the pumpkin. Other than that, I'm all on board.
Yeah, this is from Bottle Logic here in Anaheim, where, for those that don't know where Anaheim is where either Disneyland you may be familiar with, or where the Anaheim Angels play,
right,
or the Ducks. But it's close by to me, and their barrel program is just out of this world. So
I love those. I love it when they age them in those bourbon
yeah.
barrels, because it gives it like mm-hmm. that whiskey or bourbon taste to
yeah.
it. Just
yeah.
love those.
Yeah, yeah. So it's a double coffee. I figured that's a good way to start the day today.
That counts as breakfast, right?
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. So how's things going out there?
Things are going great, other than the fact that it's really cold.
Mm-hmm.
As you mentioned, we're doing the Whole 30 again. So I'm sure the women that listen will be upset to know that it's been less than a week and I've already lost like 8 pounds. Because that's just what we as guys do. We drop weight when we just focus on it. Things are going good. How are you doing out there?
Good. It's actually been cold and kind of rainy the last
wow.
few days. Cold for here.
Yeah.
You know, that comes with an asterisk. I think yesterday the high was like 55 or 58 or something,
which
I will
chilly.
Gladly take. Yeah, it's good enough here. And actually had to turn on the heat for a couple minutes this morning to get some of the chill out of the air in the apartment. So I'll take it. I love it. So otherwise, yeah, just trucking along. Had a couple days off here. It's been really nice. And yeah.
Good stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, I know when this airs, it's obviously the holiday season.
Right.
So, you know, as just you and I on a tap room, I think we should tell everybody happy holidays.
Happy holidays. Because we're going to upload this probably
in a week.
In a
so
week?
This
so like the 19th?
19th? Yeah.
Something like that. Yeah.
So Christmas
a week away
will be
from
right
Christmas.
Around the corner. Yeah. New Year's, you know, right behind the tails of that. So caffeinators, if you guys are working the holidays.
Kudos to you.
Kudos to you. Best of luck getting through your shifts. I'll be on the phones myself. I think I'm working all of them except New Year's Eve.
Mm-hmm.
So good
as
luck,
we
everybody.
As we get older, New Year's Eve is not as big of a deal as it used to be.
It's still one of my favorites. I love the idea of like a fresh start, but
yeah.
also New Year's Day, I literally spend all day watching college football, and that's like one day that I want to be off. So
yeah well, good for you.
Yeah, so that's one I usually request. Molly's usually in bed by like 9 o'clock.
we usually fall asleep for a little while, and then you know, maybe wake up at like 11:30. They often say we saw this the other day. If you see anyone over 40 outside, out and about after 9 o'clock, guaranteed they took a nap that day.
True story. You know, we were talking about doing this tap room, right after we recorded our episode with Harold,
yeah.
which if you haven't listened to that episode yet, is our most recent episode last week. Check it out. Really great episode. And we got into a discussion,
after we stopped recording.
After
we're done, yeah.
Yeah. And you and I think both are kicking ourselves because we both thought it, but neither of us actually said out loud, like, hey, Harold, stop for a minute. Let us start recording
yeah.
this again. Because it would have been another, like, just additional awesome 20-minute conversation
yeah.
to record. But what came out of that was he mentioned something to us where we asked the question towards the end of the episode, you know, is there anything else you want to get out to the listeners or what have you? And he brought up this American Association of Critical Care Nurses standards of healthy work environments.
And
we'll put a link in
this is human nurses.
This is human nursing,
yeah.
correct. And so if it's put out by the American Association of Critical Care Nurses, again, on the human side, we'll put the link in the
yeah.
show notes, but if you lose it or you're listening and you just want to look at it, if you just Google, AACN, which is the American Association of Critical Care Nurses, Healthy Work Environments. It's the first website that'll come up.
Yep.
And there are these six standards, and Harold kind of walked us through all six and described all six. And then he was headed to another, you know, profession summit. I don't know what else to call it this week. And he was going to bring up this idea of how we could translate it to veterinary medicine. And it was a fascinating, fascinating discussion.
And I don't think we even need to translate it. I think it's all, it's all transferable. All this stuff is stuff that we know that we need.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And then, so you and I looked at that kind of later in the day after that discussion, and there are these six standards of healthy work environments. And I think we'll kind of go through all six of them here and hit some of the highlights. But I think if you guys listen to it, because I can certainly relate, all six of these things are major, major problems
in veterinary hospitals
across the country and probably around the world.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Let's be real.
Yeah. So anyway, start us off, Dave. Pick one and we'll go from there. Skilled
communication. That's the first one. Being able to communicate. And oftentimes that's something that we are not great at because, I mean, think about what most people say. Why do we get into veterinary professions? Because we don't want to deal with people. And a lot of that is because we're not really good communicators. And you and I have talked a lot about the fact that there are I don't know if the number is 50%, maybe it's even more, of us are introverts, right? We're not comfortable talking to people. Me personally, I'm an introvert until I have to turn it on and talk to people. So I kind of have that way that I can get out of my introvert zone. But for the most part, we're not great at communicating. And, one of the things that we talked about with Rebecca Rose was, working on your soft skills. Your soft skills are those things that are communication, being able to communicate with each other, with your clients, and just having good phone etiquette, good body posture, all those things that allow us to, in this profession, there's so much that we don't know, right? Because our pets can't tell us what's wrong. With our coworkers and with our clients, we should be able to communicate a lot better than the pets can with us. I think that's something that's really important to have. All of these are really important to have, but skill communication is one that I see as lacking throughout the profession. Whether it's pettiness, whether it's shaming, whether it's bullying, all that stuff.
Right.
Without that communication, what's the point? You're not going to get anything done.
Right. And, looking at this here. So when we click on skill communication, there are five critical elements for organizations and eight for individuals. And when I think about communication specifically, I feel like that's something that's only getting worse. And I worry that in this digital age, when nobody talks on the phone anymore, like how many of those memes do you see that are just like, if you want to get in touch with me, don't call me. I won't answer. I won't listen to your voicemail. Just send me a text. Nobody knows how to talk on the phone anymore or have that face-to-face interaction. And I feel like that's only getting worse. And I had mentioned this to Harold, Molly, who's emergency veterinarian. She brought this up to me a long time ago that it doesn't matter how good of a veterinarian you are. If you cannot effectively communicate to an owner why you want to run these tests or why you're doing the treatments that you're doing, who's going to sign that estimate?
Right, exactly.
You have to be able to effectively communicate. And when I think back in some of the clinics that I've worked in, there were leaders that were strong communicators and there was leadership that weren't. And I mean, I feel like, and I think a lot of these, all six of these kind of, as we go through there will be some overlap or some kind of feeding into each other.
Yeah. But yeah.
I think in so many ways, communication and being able to effectively communicate, is huge.
Oh, agreed.
Yeah.
Let's see. Number two is true collaboration. Another thing that is, all these are really lacking, I think in our profession. I've been thinking about this one a lot, and that true collaboration, I think this is where there is a difference in the veterinary side and the human side of things, because I mean, we've talked about this before a lot. That collaboration is like-minded people, people with similar skill sets, similar knowledge bases being able to communicate with each other. And when you talk about the veterinary profession, we have a lot of veterinary assistants that are doing veterinary technician skills. So I think a lot of times that, I don't want to say it's not respected, but I think a lot of times the knowledge that a veterinary assistant has is kind of discounted, even though, you know, somebody that's 10, 15 years in the field as a veterinary assistant probably may have more knowledge or more experience than a technician fresh out of school. So I think, you know, that's a really compounded part of this six steps that in the veterinary world is really difficult to do.
Right. And it has to be about also checking your ego at the door.
Oh, yeah.
That you're not going to know everything about every patient all of the time.
Right.
Sure. You know, yeah, maybe somebody brings up an idea and it's not even necessarily off the wall. It's just not on the right path.
Right.
Again, going back to that first point, the effective communication, all you have to do is say something to the effect of, you know, it's a really great point. Here's why I'm not looking in that direction.
Yeah.
Or like, you know, and but still then have that collaborative effort and not just shoot somebody down so that they're not going to say anything in the future. Like,
that's exactly what's going to happen. Yeah.
Right. And everybody on a team, if you look at in your individual hospitals, whether you have four employees or 400, you are going to have people who are stronger in certain areas than others. Lean into that.
Yeah.
Like, allow, you know, if you have those cases and somebody is really dentistry motivated or really ophtho motivated, allow those people to kind of help drive some of that. And if they get enjoyment out of that, then all the better. Like, so the true collaboration one, like, again, I think there is, you know, that kind of crossover with communication as well, but there are so many people, like you're saying, with veterinary assistants or credential technicians or whoever, who have these unique skills or unique knowledge bases in certain areas. Let them be part of the case management, and not just, you know, you make a treatment sheet and then, you know, people fill in numbers and check boxes and what have you. Actually critically think about what's going on with that patient and reevaluate things and touch base with you at a certain point during the day and say, here's where we're at. Here's where I think we could be better. Here's where we've maybe gone a little too far. Whatever it is, collaborate.
And also
collaborate and listen.
And also going back to what we're talking about with, you know, people with different knowledge bases and what have you, that goes back to communication, and it also ties in with leadership, which is going to come up at the end here. If somebody suggests something that is just, like you said, completely off the wall, completely wrong, what's going to happen to that person? They're going to say, oh, I sounded like an idiot there, so I'm never going to speak up again. And then you lose that collaboration, because suddenly you have somebody that's not participating at all. And I mean, that goes into job satisfaction. It goes into mental health, and eventually somebody leaving the field because they're feeling not valued.
Yeah. Molly and I were just talking about this the other day. You know, she started a new job at a different ER, actually the ER where we met here in town. And, she's now one of their ER doctors. And she was saying, you know, starting a new job, she's a little bit nervous because she goes back to her time as an intern, and every morning in rounds, you know, it was like, here are five things you screwed up on your shift yesterday or on your overnight. And so like every shift, she carries that weight with her.
Yeah.
Like she is every shift. She's not practicing medicine. She's practicing medicine to not screw up and get blasted in rounds the next day. And she's still 2 years out carrying that with her.
Yeah.
And it's just like, that's not true collaboration.
No, that's defensive working. Like where you're, like you said, you're doing what you're doing just to not get in trouble.
Right.
Which is terrible.
It's just, no. And that in a nutshell, to me, when I think about veterinary technicians training new assistants or new technicians, or, you know, going back to my time in academia and faculty training interns or residents or students or whoever, that to me is a huge part of what's broken in this field. Mm-hmm. It's not teaching.
No,
I don't know another word for it, but it's
policing.
Lambasting.
Yeah.
It's just, and again, that's poor communication.
Yep.
That's a group of people who are really, really, really smart, but are not effective at communicating their knowledge mm-hmm. for other people to learn it.
You know, we started out saying that, you know, some of these tie into each other. I think they all tie into each other. Like we can put we can draw lines between all six of these things and make it all make sense.
Yeah. Yeah. So the next one here is effective decision making. And I know, you know, Harold and I kind of both laughed about this one when we were talking about it off record, because we both come from academia and we both could relate to the idea that the people that were making decisions very clearly did not work on the floor. Mm-hmm. And when I think back to my time at Tufts, just after I started there, when I started there, they were going through a major hospital renovation. And I gave this example to Harold, and he could completely relate, that they were renovating basically the entire teaching hospital. And they were putting in a new lobby. Now, when you come in from the parking lot, if you're going into the lobby, you come into this vestibule, right? It's New England. It pours, it snows, the whole bit. So there's this little vestibule, and you continue straight ahead into the lobby, or you can go through a door to the right that's like a key card door, and it's a back hallway that leads right to the ER. When they designed that hospital, they purposely made the door into that hallway so narrow that a gurney cannot fit through it, because they didn't want staff going through that hallway.
Yeah.
With a gurney.
Yeah.
So what you had to do then, coming in from the parking lot, you had to go through that vestibule, wheel that patient through the lobby.
Ugh.
All the way around. And so now you're coming straight at the ER instead of going the side hallway and taking a right turn and being right there. Now you have to wheel this seizuring, dead, bloody, whatever animal through the lobby.
A waiting room of people.
Right. And the funny thing is the hallway is more than wide enough. They put in a door, and then on each side of the door, there are windows.
Yeah.
They just purposely elected to not put in a wide enough door to have us avoid using it. And we went to administration time and time and time and time again till we were blue in the face and like, why would you do this?
Yeah,
we don't want you going through that way. Why not? Like this is,
if they don't want you going through that way, why put a door there at all?
Right. Like here we are doing CPR on a gurney an extra 150 feet with three extra turns. And the funny thing is now when you go through the lobby and you're coming straight at the ER, well, that intersection of that back hallway and the hallway you actually had to take is a major thoroughfare in the hospital. Mm-hmm. I cannot tell you how many people I took out with a gurney when I was hauling ass trying to get into ER as fast as I could, because it's a blind corner.
Yeah.
You can't see anybody. And it's just another one of those examples of clearly the people making the decisions had no clue how the hospital was going to run, how it could be most effective, most efficient, what have you. And that kind of, to me, goes also back to the true collaboration.
Like, I was just going to say.
Stakeholders were not involved in the decision-making process.
Yeah. And that's one example, but
clearly
states, I mean, that kind of goes through all of them. It goes through effective decision-making, goes through collaboration, goes through communication, goes through leadership.
Right. Absolutely.
All you have
to say is like, oh my gosh, we never thought of that. Like, we'll put in a bigger door. That makes way more sense.
Yeah.
But instead, like, no, I refuse to be wrong.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, we made this decision. It's going to cost X amount of dollars to reframe that door. We're not doing it. You have to go around. Like, and instead just saying no. Like,
building something that doesn't work.
Right.
Doesn't make any sense.
Right. Absolutely.
All right. Well, the fourth
next
one
one's a big one.
Is one that we all know. We could probably spend like 30 seconds on this and just move on. Appropriate staffing. I mean, that one of the biggest problems in the field right now is not having appropriate staffing. We talked about the tech to patient ratio being 4-to-1 is ideal. Many places that is not the case. 5, 6, 10-to-1 is what we're dealing with. And you know, it was
not uncommon to be like 15-to-1 when I worked in academia.
Yeah.
And again, you know, that's what they don't realize is inadvertently that's what you're training future veterinarians to expect and to be okay with.
Like,
that's the norm. That's the standard. That's however you want to frame it. And that's a load of crap.
Yeah. I mean, that doesn't happen in every practice. I mean, if they go to GP, obviously sure. that may not be the case.
Sure. Yeah, you're not going to have that many inpatients.
If they go to a rural ER, it's not going to be the case.
Right.
But I mean,
right.
Maybe it's just that they were showing them worst case scenario.
Right.
I mean,
yeah.
But still, we need more staff. We need staff to be paid better.
All those things.
That's going to improve appropriate staffing and planning. Like, again, it goes down to decision making. Make that decision that, hey, we could pay somebody $12 an hour, but we're going to get a $12 an hour technician or a $12 an hour assistant.
Right. And then the one other point I want to bring in here as well as it was something else Harold mentioned is having appropriate leveled or appropriately trained staff work on appropriate patients. So, you know, if you have the most skilled person in the room, you know, maybe I'm just going to use this as an example because we're VTS ECC, you know, maybe you're working in ICU, having your VTS ECC working on, you know, a bunch of vomiting, diarrhea, or say like milder cases while
post-op ACL.
A credentialed credentialed technician, but a non-VTS is working on a vent case.
Right.
You know, leveraging those skills and having appropriate cases assigned to appropriate staff members. And then one of the points it makes in here in this document is then having a formal process in place to evaluate the effect of staffing decisions based on patient outcomes and system outcomes and actually evaluating your plan. Like, are you having mismatched patients to technicians? And that idea, I think, is something that is never even considered.
I think that some of that, I mean, I may be wrong here, but I think a lot of that goes right into the staffing. Like
For sure.
If you don't have time 100%. To look at that,
you don't have that option.
You don't have that option. So there's no time to like step back and say, okay, let's evaluate what we're doing. Let's get off the floor and look at stuff. There's no time to get off the floor because everyone's swamped.
Right. So, and you made the point while we were talking about this with Harold that a lot of times I had said geographical, but a lot of times it was you and one other person, you just split the room, right? Start at one end and you meet somewhere in
the middle.
And if one of you get through 8 patients and the other of you get through 12, whatever, you just meet wherever you stop. And then the next hour, the next treatment hour, you just start it again. But you know, then you think about that, like, how effectively are you treating those patients? Are you just like checking boxes and making sure that what's supposed to be done is done? And damn, that's not.
Well, when you're that, the ratio is that bad.
That's the reality.
You're just a box checker. That's what you're doing.
That's unfortunate. Yeah, exactly. That's unfortunately what it becomes.
And I realize we're
the reality.
Guys, we're speaking.
We're beating a dead horse.
Beating a dead horse. And we're speaking from an ECC standpoint.
Right.
Where we work in like high level emergency rooms, you know, you with Tufts, not always the same with general practice, but I mean, general practices also know that.
But again, I was going to say, like, I think it's still a transferable idea. It might not be inpatients. It might be other rooms and tech appointments and, you know, dentistry to do or co-hats or what have you. So like, I feel like you can take this idea or these ideas and translate them into whatever kind of practice you are, and you will find some parallels.
I think another part of it, and I see this in some of the general practices that I work at, is that they staff to get to effective, right? So they staff to get, they've got 2 doctors, one tech per doctor in room and one floater, right? So, but what happens when one of them calls out? Then you're not staffed appropriately, and they kind of staff to the bare minimum, not realizing that
let me ask you something. How many people does it take to work on any one animal at one time?
Two.
So why is one of them the doctor? So like you need 2 people per doctor, and then a floater. Like otherwise, the floater's going to be tied up with one, and somebody's going to be stuck in the mud.
Yep.
Like and that's. That's that efficiency. That's that effective decision making. That's that's all of these things. Like you can't. Anyway.
Well, and I worked one of the shifts I worked. I wouldn't say it was recent, but it was maybe a month or so ago, you know, that we were short and I'm the relief tech, so I'm coming in to help anyways. But in the afternoon we had one tech per doctor and we had no floater and six tech appointments to come in. When are those going to get taken care of? And when are we going to get discharges from the surgeries out of the room? It's just something that we need to staff. We need to overstaff because at some point we're going to lose staff. At some point we're going to have somebody that can't be there. Or I've also worked in places where they have a really hard time saying no to people that call in and say, hey, can I come in today? Even though they're fully staffed.
Right.
They'll say, oh yeah, we'll just fit you in. Not actually looking back and saying, and again, that ties into collaboration, decision-making, leadership.
All of the things. Yeah.
I know we said we're only going to talk for 5 seconds on appropriate staffing, but...
Right. But again, like it's one of those things that really ties into so many different things.
It does.
And I know we all know how short we are on staff and all of those problems. So again, I don't want to, you know, get into that too much, but... It's there are some other facets to appropriate staffing that's not just how many people do you have at one time. It's actually the evaluation of your processes and is what you're doing working?
Yeah.
Is it affecting patient care positively or negatively?
Right.
And if it's affecting it negatively, you've really got to reevaluate that.
Well, and think about those times where you're swamped, you're overloaded. Your attitude changes, your mood changes, and
yeah, for sure.
I mean,
you're distracted,
you're upset, you're
all of these
you're
things.
You're maybe angry at the patient, even though the patient has no fault.
And then damn it, you take that home with you at the end of the day.
Yeah.
And you start off your day when you wake up the next morning still carrying that and knowing you're gonna be walking into that again today. Like we are empaths. We take that with us.
Yeah.
Like it's an impossible cycle to break. And the thing is that it takes people and time to evaluate that and break the cycle. And unfortunately, that's just what we don't have right now.
We don't have it.
But, like you have to make that a priority and make that time to fix the problem.
Yeah.
Or it's never, or you're just going to be stuck in this perpetual,
this vicious cycle. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, what's next?
Meaningful recognition is going to be next. And I think this is one top to bottom.
Yeah. And this
anybody
is,
in the hospital.
This is more than pizza.
Needs more of.
Even though right now, with me being on the Whole 30, pizza sounds like a fantastic idea. I would love to be recognized with pizza right now. but yeah, meaningful recognition, praise. And like you said with Molly, like talk about the good things that happen. Don't beat them down in rounds. Cause how does that make anyone feel any better? Doesn't do anything.
This is one that I tried, especially my last little while at Tufts, to really really do back to the doctors I was working with on a case, celebrate your wins.
Yeah.
If there is a tough case in the hospital and it gets discharged, celebrate that.
Yeah.
Congratulate everybody and technicians and assistants that are living or not living that are listening.
Congratulate
your right. Absolutely. Congratulate your doctor on a job well done. The meaningful recognition does not have to just come from the top down.
It's
be
true.
A leader in your clinic and put it back up to the top.
Yeah.
Because sometimes we all know this, like there are really, really difficult cases in your hospital and many times they don't leave.
Right.
When they do, celebrate that victory. And I used to work with so many interns and residents that were like, well, this is what I'm supposed to do. Shut up.
Yeah.
Like you did a good job on this case. Mm-hmm. Allow yourself to feel some gratitude, allow yourself to celebrate that.
Because what happens when it goes bad? You beat yourself up.
Right.
So
then
pat yourself on the back when it goes right?
Absolutely. And that can be doctor patting technician on the back for recognizing a patient was slipping down a slope.
Yeah.
That can be a technician patting a doctor on the back and saying, man, like I never saw this coming. How did you know this? Like great job. Like celebrate those small victories because frankly, this day and age, they are too few and far between. Yeah. And if all you ever think is, well, that's what we're supposed to do, and then when, as you said, Dave, when things don't go well, as many times they don't, you're just beating yourself up. Mm-hmm. When the hell are you ever happy in this profession?
Right, exactly. And we have a few places that I work. I'm trying to think of what they do. The place Robin works at, they have like a, I don't want to call it a thank you board, but like a kudos board where there's just like a stack of post-it notes, and you put a nice message on for somebody helped me out with this. Thank you for doing that. Another practice I work at, we use Slack, which is a communication platform, and there's an entire section of just kudos where you go in and you say, good job, everybody, for what we did this night or on this patient. Yeah. I think that's, it's one, again, another thing that is missing in this field. And if we think about, I mean, we think about mental health all the time, but if you think about that, how are we going to stay in this field if, like you said, we're feeling crappy all the time?
Right. Like where are you drawing your positive reinforcement from? Like, we don't see enough puppies and kittens to make up for all the the terribleness that we do see. So like what, Caffeinators, I'll ask you, where are you drawing your positive reinforcement from?
Yeah.
Because if you're not getting it from the cases that go well or that you do a good job on, I don't know where else you're going to get it.
Yeah.
I don't know where else you're going to get it in this field.
Yeah. Other than like internally self-congratulating yourself.
Yeah,
but
yeah, absolutely.
We need that from other people. We need that from other people.
And again, keep in mind, that doesn't necessarily have to come from the top down.
No, not at all.
You can be a leader and put it from the bottom to the top. It's a great job, doc. Or, hey, practice manager, I know like we've been harping on you a lot lately, but I really appreciate that you made this change after, you know, we've been talking about it for a while.
Yeah.
It's really working well. Like, give them some positive reinforcement too. Like
everybody needs that.
And I challenge you to find an area in your clinic where it's not being displayed, because I'm sure there are areas where not only it can be displayed to you, you can display it to others.
Yeah. And again, ties into leadership, ties into decision-making, collaboration, skill communication, all these things.
Right. Which, kind of a segue, the authentic leadership is the last one.
Yeah. And that's really hard, I think, in this field, because I don't have the numbers, so I don't want to speak out of turn, but I would imagine that the majority of practice managers or practice leadership is either a veterinarian or somebody that is not veterinary related whatsoever. And I do realize that there are,
the longest tenured person there.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. What is it called? CVPM? Certified Veterinary Practice Manager. I mean, how many of those are there? There's not a whole lot of those. And those are people that have actually, and I'm not trying to say that other practice managers are not doing their best, but those are the people that kind of, like us, they go above and beyond what they're expected to do to be the best at their job.
Right.
And I think that's just not there. And I think we need more of that. And I think we need leadership that is going to listen instead of just lead. A lot of times, people on one of my reviews, where I was a supervisor and I stepped down from being a supervisor because I don't want to manage people. I want to manage cases, but that's a whole other story. But I kind of took a step down from that leadership role. And one of the comments on one of my reviews, said that you may not be in that leadership role anymore, but you are a VTS. If you want to or not, you are a leader. And you have to take that on, because people are going to look to you and say,
sure,
you know what you're doing. I'm going to try to emulate you. Whereas that kind of even goes not just to VTSs, but it goes to the most senior tech, the most senior doctor. And just thinking about how you're behaving and how you're acting in your clinics.
Yeah.
Because people are going to see that and either, whether or not you want to be judged, you're going to be judged based on what you do.
Right. And to your point, you know, you talk about fine having that leadership role. Absolutely. Like that's, I think for me, I'm the same way, Dave. Like people have been asking me, we've got a couple of positions open at my current job and, you know, some training or some management positions. And they're like, why don't you, you know, apply for those? I think you'd be great. I know myself. I am a poor manager of people.
Right.
I don't want to be a manager of people. I like talking to clients on the phone and talking them off of a ledge and telling them their pet is going to be fine and what to watch for at home. I like what I'm doing currently. And being a leader does not have to be, okay, you're the most senior person here. You're our leader. Now you also have to do inventory, do the hiring and firing and do all of these things. No, no, no. You can be a leader in whatever role you are in. And just by the way you your attitude and the way you go about your work, you can, sure, you might not have a supervisor position, but you can do training, you can be encouraging, you can do all of these things without having a supervisor or a manager title and still be a leader. And all of these things that we've talked about, this is the sixth and final kind of category, if you will, here, all of these other five come back to effective leadership.
Yeah.
And that is, like you were saying earlier, that's something that is, or authentic leadership, excuse me, something that is highly lacking in our clinic because so many times, and I think back to my GP days, and this is something we talked to, I think, David Liss and Ed Carlson about, is that it ultimately ends up being the most senior person on staff who has all, who just by default gets all of these management roles, whether they want them or not.
Right.
And as technicians, we don't have a career ladder where we can continue to advance and make more money. So taking on those responsibilities, we're looking at it as, hey, it's an extra few dollars an hour. I can do that. Like that's
it'll be fine. Worth it.
But they're given no tools to succeed. They're not giving any management training classes.
Right.
They're not given any parameters. They're just like, here, take this over and do this. And how long does that last?
When you're talking about that, the training that they get is how to do the tasks, but not necessarily how to lead.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Well, we made it through all six.
Yes. Yes. So again, we will post the link here, but I highly encourage anybody that is listening to this episode. We'll put the link, but if you Google American Association of Critical Care Nurses or AACN, and just then kind of put next to that, healthy work environments. You will get to the main page here. And what we've been talking about are the six standards of healthy work environments, that have been, you know, put in place and adapted in the human medicine world. But I challenge you to find at any of these that cannot be applied to your current work situation. And absolutely, we need to be doing more of that. And I really want to thank Harold for bringing that to my attention because I had no idea.
I didn't either because, I mean, it's a human nursing thing. We don't really look up human nursing things.
Right. And then I won't go in too much into it, but then if you look at this a little bit deeper, there is some data here on about how when you improve all six of these things, patient outcomes are improved, worker satisfaction is improved, all of those things, and ultimately
a healthy environment.
Yeah.
Someday.
So anyway, caffeinators, check it out. See how you can apply it to your practice. And if you do, let us know. We'd love to hear.
We'll make some social media posts and kind of post some questions to everybody. See if we get some responses.
Absolutely. So the other thing I think, Dave, we wanted to talk about this week, our recent guest, Becky Mosser, who caffeinators, you may remember, we talked to her extensively about the veterinary industry giving tree, which it's that time of year. So if you haven't already, definitely check that out. But you may remember as well, she co-hosts a podcast of her own called The Veterinary Viewfinder with Dr. Ernie Ward. And it's been a weekly podcast. How long did we say? Like five years,
something like that. Yeah.
Something like that. A long while.
Yeah.
And they just talk about a whole bunch of different things across
veterinary medicine. They usually talk about like whatever's current, like what's the current topic.
Absolutely. And so they put out one of their I don't think it's their most recent now.
I think it is.
Another one has come in.
Oh, has, well, by, since. By the time this uploads.
By now.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh yeah. By the time this uploads for sure. But they put out an episode talking about a lot of the discussion about the mid-level practitioner position and specifically, what is it? The master's degree in veterinary clinical care.
I think it's clinical care. Yeah.
And a lot of our friends and colleagues and people we've had as guests on the show, you know, have shared some of the ideas and thoughts. So you might have seen some discussion about this online, and we kind of wanted to jump in the fray too, because it's something we've talked about with a few different people. And actually, we talked a little bit about it with Harold as well.
We did, yeah.
And they made some really great points.
Becky had some really good thoughts on this. And the thing that stuck out with me is that how are we going to have another level of a veterinary staff when we're still like how are we valuing education when we're still hiring people off the street, like still hiring people. I think Ernie called it someone that was working at the Gap yesterday. Like how are we going to have advanced degrees when we're still taking people off the street, which to me is just that's a perfect example of why this isn't going to work now. I feel like it can work, but right now it cannot.
Right. And Becky used the analogy, we're trying to put a roof on a house that doesn't have a foundation.
Right, exactly.
Or something along those lines.
I think that's what it was.
And yeah. And we've talked about, I mean, sure, it's a great goal to have, but there is so much groundwork that has to be laid, improved, so much infrastructure that has to be improved. There is so much that has to be figured out.
And
before
fixed.
We even and yeah. fixed before we even, you know, consider doing that. And again, Caffeinators, I highly recommend you listen to this episode to get some background and some context here. Again, I just pulled it up here. So the Veterinary Viewfinder podcast is available on all major channels, but the specific episodes from this past Wednesday, Master's Degree in Veterinary Clinical Care, Pioneering Pathway or Misguided MS. And so basically the idea here is that, you know, you go to school, you go into this program, you get a master's degree in this kind of, frankly, fabricated topic or discipline, I guess it is, of veterinary clinical care, which define that. Okay. But how do we utilize that?
Right.
How do we we have nothing established in any practice act in any state in the United States that is prepared to address and handle some kind of veterinary technician with a master's degree and what that means for their clinical practice. So to some degree, sometimes I wonder, do we have to have the degree in place for then to make action in the practice act, or do we have to put action in the practice act first and then develop the programs in response to that? And I don't know what the right answer is on that, honestly.
I mean, just, you know, my knee-jerk reaction says that without the practice acts being corrected, no one's going to there's no reason for it, really.
Right, exactly. And I completely agree. So then I go back to, okay, in the V&I is a whole separate discussion, so I won't get into that. But part of that is opening up the practice acts, right, and getting into this model practice act. And you have to do that in all 50 states. So if, and it is a massive if, I need like big white letters behind me that are blinking and saying if we ever get to the point where states are going to open up their practice act, then whenever that happens, we're probably going to get one shot at that, like I've said before. Then that's when we have to have this kind of goal or ideal in place and say, we want this added because this is the direction we want to go. Not that there should already be programs in place that are graduating students and handing out this piece of paper that frankly currently means nothing. But if and when that does ever happen, if that's the goal, then we need to be prepared for that. And we can't get caught with our pants down and saying, well, we opened up the practice act, but we weren't ready for this. And now it's going to be another 20 years before we ever get to do that.
Well, I think this is like the one example where, you know, the old adage of it's easier to ask for forgiveness than permission. I think this is the opposite. Without permission, we're never going to get any of this done.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And so, and she made some other great points as well. And one of the things, that you and I talked a little bit about last night and has been actually a lot of discussion online and we've discussed it with some of our guests as well, is that, you know, this idea of a mid-level practitioner, there's already something that exists that could fulfill that role, and that's the VTS.
Yeah.
And Becky made the point, whereas as a non-VTS, she knows a little about a lot of things, and as a VTS, you know a lot about a few things.
I
understand where you're coming from. And I think that, and then she kind of reconciled that a little bit a minute or two later when she said, you know, I, as a VTS emergency and critical care, I'm not going to be expected to go into a general practice.
Right.
And be, I'm going to use the phrase nurse practitioner. I realize that's not right, but just for simplicity's sake, and go be this nurse practitioner role. I might be able to do that in an ER.
Right.
And as she uses the example, you know, if a doctor's in surgery, maybe I can take some basic cases, prescribe some antibiotics or some basic medications, different things. Whatever your VTS discipline is, that's where you would be expected to fulfill that role, not just across veterinary medicine at large. And so, I think it's a fantastic idea. Again, though, there is just so much infrastructure to get fixed before we get to that point. However, I do think we also need to, like, as a strategic plan, I do believe we have to have something like that in our mind, almost as a dangled carrot to help drive some of this. We need to get this fixed. And this is why, because this is what we want to do.
Right.
And again, but we can't be implementing this now and throwing 10 other wrenches in where we're already screwed up.
Well, and I said this with when we were talking with Harold, is that right now I'm seeing a lot of similarities with this type of thing that's being proposed that he saw when they were proposing the VTS.
Yes.
Like the backlash of, why do we need this? What's the point of this?
Right.
I think maybe the arguments are slightly different now because we do have VTSs and there are, you know, logistical things. But back then, it's kind of the similar thing where they're like, well, who needs that? Like, why do we have to do that? But I think, you know, if we want to move forward, if we want to, like you said, give technicians a ladder to go up. I mean, other than going from assistant or kennel to assistant to tech to practice manager, and then you're done.
Right. What else is there?
Right.
Yeah. And you know, it's interesting because, you know, here we're talking about not putting the cart before the horse, but yet, you know, you think about the entire VTSs. NAVTA is the governing body of all of these academies, and it's wonderful that all of these exist, but again, none of them exist in any of the 50 states practice acts. We have a skills list and we have all of this stuff that we have to learn and do and master and an exam we have to pass and what have you. But walking into this neurology clinic or that oncology clinic or this ER, there is nothing in statute about what a VTS can do that a credentialed technician can't do. So here we are, I think 25 years later, since what is now AVECT informed, we still don't have that regulation.
Right.
So we're kind of behind the eight ball in that. And I fear that with this kind of thing, if we start rolling out these programs to hand out this master's degree, we're still going to be 25, 30 years in the future from now and still not have it.
And still not have it. Because, I mean,
and they'd still be meaningless.
They've been trying to open them for the V&I for 20 plus years. So,
right. Right. And so, you know, the more that we kind of get behind the eight ball, then the more, in terms of going in and getting all of this addressed, the more daunting of a task that becomes and the less likely it is that we're actually going to be able to do that. And so again, I think it's a fantastic idea, and I would love 50 years from now for that to be an actual position with actual regulation and utilization and the whole thing. We're just not there.
We're not there. Yeah. I mean,
And
like you said, it's a great idea to have, but there's so many more things we have to fix before we get to this.
So there are so many layers and levels across all 50 states. And she mentions, you know, things we've talked about, title protection, reciprocity, utilization, all of these things that we've talked to the umpteenth degree about. We can't get on board with something like this and figure, like, how are we going to utilize this person? How are we going to pay them? How are we going to this, that, or the other? How are we going to regulate them? We can't be doing this with a brand new position when all of the other positions in the hospital don't even have that figured out yet.
Right. Yeah. It's like a, Jim Gaffigan tells a joke of like, what is it like having twins? It's like, imagine you're in a pool and you're drowning and you're holding a baby and then someone gives you another baby. It's the same thing. Like we're trying to keep the profession afloat. And then someone saying, right. Oh, here's a whole other thing.
Have a baby.
Have a baby. Well, buddy, I mean, this is as long as our normal episodes, and
yeah,
I know the tap rooms are usually short, but
yeah, this is a longer tap room, but we had some really interesting stuff.
I think it's meaningful about today, conversation. So. Yeah.
Yeah. So anyway, you know, caffeinators, when you hear this episode, you know, post on it, let us know your thoughts on the Healthy Workplace Environment Initiative, on the advanced credential or the mid-level practitioner discussion. We'll have some posts about it. Let us know your thoughts, your concerns, or if you're super for it, let us know why.
Yeah.
We'd love to continue to put that discussion
and
out there.
We'll post some questions on our social media to kind of generate some discussion.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
All right,
guys. Well, thanks for coming by the Vet Tech Tap Room. Hopefully you guys had a good beer like I did. And cheers to you, caffeinators. Dave, Merry Christmas to you.
Merry Christmas.
In a week.
Happy holidays.
And happy holidays, happy new year, and we will see all you guys soon.
Bye, guys.